you right off the start?
Good. I need everybody to come move closer. Come on, let's just stand up, greet each other again, and move up. Let's say the first three rows. Let's do that. If you're in the first three, you're okay. And there's a method to my madness, and you don't want to be the one not sitting in the first three rows, because, you know, like in Disney or in SeaWorld, they have the splash zone. You know where that is, right? It's near the front, so when the whale jumps up and splashes, everybody in the front gets soaked. And, well, it just feels better when we're all together in one. Oh, look, he's going to sit in the fourth row, just to be defined. Look at that. That's okay. Good stuff. Well, today's kind of a... You've all heard the term preaching to the choir, right? Well, today I want to kind of deliver a message on why attending church is important. And you're here, so you must know why it's important. But how many of you know why it's important? Why is it important that we attend church on a Sunday morning? Why is it that we even have church? Because for a lot of us, we do it strictly out of tradition, right? Forsake not. Hebrews chapter 10. Draw near, closer to the end, right? You read my text for me. Good job. Whatever. This is, open it up. I want you to take a minute to think about this, because I want you to be serious. I want you to not just spurt off the top thing, first thing off the top of your head. Why do you come to church? Be spiritually fit? Fed. Oh, fed. Eat, of course. Yes. Spiritually fed. Somebody else. And there's only a few of us here, so I'm going to, might even ask every single person. So start thinking of your answer. And as you're thinking of your answer, you can actually turn to the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 19. Hebrews chapter 10, 19. But don't think I'm letting you off the hook. I want your answers. Where we gather together, he's in our midst. Good one. Give you a chance. Why do you come to church? To worship God? Fellowship? Seeking? Okay. Kenna? To enrich your walk with the Lord? Yes. Good. To hear the word? Feel good. Makes you feel good. Good answer. Because you're not going to go somewhere where you don't feel good, right? So, any others? This is your chance to speak up in church, you know, because there's not many people here, so you can do it without being afraid. And we got lots of time this morning. It's only 10 to... we got like hours today, right? Because nobody's got anything this afternoon, right? No, no. It's raining, so you can't go outside, so you might as well stay inside. What's that? You could walk in the rain, you could. You very well could. To bring your tithes? Oh, that's another good one. We don't think of that, right? What are some other reasons? Come on, this side's answering lots. How about over here? Filled up and refreshed? Good. To leave your cares and problems at the altar? Good answer. Don't worry, I'm not... Actually, there's a specific answer I'm looking for, and it's already been said, but I want to hear your reasons, right? To grow? Good. Because this is really something you have to decide in your heart of hearts. You have to make... And the reason why I say that is there is an adversary. There is a devil. And he is doing everything he can do in his power to prevent you from coming to church. He does everything he can. So if you are not resolute in your determination, you will fall prey to his tactics. And you will time and time again. And how can I say that? Well, look around you. Look around you. This place should be full on a Sunday morning, but it's not, because the devil is winning in many people's lives. Now, I'm not saying this as an absolute. I'm not saying this to say, oh, if you don't come to church, you're going to hell. Okay, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that the church is the vessel. It is the organism. It is the building, the structure that God wants to carry out His work on earth through. It's been His plan since the New Testament that everything God does, He does through the church. When God acts, He acts through the church. We are the medium. We are the vessel. And again, just so we're all clear, the church is not this building. Okay? You are the church. It is the people. The people are the church. So when I say God wants to do His work through the church, what I'm saying is God wants to do His work through you. But you're not alone. You see, if God just simply wanted to work through you, He would not even need the church. He would say, go out, do what I want you to do, and leave it at that. And you know what? He did that lots in the Old Testament. There's many times where He would send a prophet alone by himself to go out and carry His message. But we all know how well that worked out for the prophets, right? Most of them were martyred. Most of them were killed. Most of them lived lives of solitude, of isolation. God knows the human heart. God knows that each and every one of us are designed for community. Each and every one of us is designed to be in fellowship with one another. So He created the church. And the job He gave each and every one of us to do is a job that we are called to do together. That job we also call ministry. Another word for ministry is service. Okay? So we're all on the same page here. We all know that God wants to do work here on this earth, and He wants to do it through us. Now, sometimes in this city of Edmonton, we can think that we got it pretty good. Okay? We don't have slum neighborhoods like many other cities do. We don't have rampant problems like other places do. It's, in actuality, a pretty well-to-do city. Unemployment's around 4%, they're saying. Very low. Crime rates are down. But I want to tell you, there's a disturbing trend that's happening just here in our neighborhood. And I'll tell you what it is, because if I get in trouble down the road, you know exactly why I got in trouble, because I'm not going to let this stand anymore. You see, this week I was standing in the foyer, of course, just doing some work back and forth, and I stopped and I saw this $45,000 vehicle driving to our parking lot. A little curious, because it did a circle and then stopped. Okay, very nice vehicle. We don't see too many of those around here. Within a minute, a young lady came walking from the hotel, 8 months pregnant at least, walks over to the car, drops some money in the guy's lap, and puts out her hand. Now, for those of you in the real world, you know what's going on. I went outside to take a discussion with this drug dealer, per se, a.k.a. As soon as he saw me, he took off. Okay? He ripped out of the parking lot and gone. We do not have to go far beyond these walls to see what the devil is doing. Any person who is obviously well off enough to own a $45,000 and low enough to sell drugs to a pregnant teenage girl has issues, has problems. I have not been able to get that out of my head. And the question I ask myself is, what are we, the church, doing about it? What are we doing? We are to be the light of the world. We're to be the salt of the earth. And yet we have drug deals happening right in our very own parking lot on a regular basis. I know what I'm going to do about it. But that is just an example of what is going on in this world.
That is just an example of the depravity and the destitution that is occurring in our neighborhoods, in our city, because the church is asleep. You get that? The church is asleep. And I'll tell you how the enemy has done this. Satan has learned that in our culture, our greatest desire is to be content. Our greatest desire is to have our needs met, and then we're happy. And you know what? The enemy has no problem with you being happy. Get that? Satan has no problem with you being happy. Because as long as you're happy and not doing what you're supposed to be doing, he's happy. So we need to take a look back. See, he's come in. He's filled our time, our resources, our energy. He's filled it up with all of these things on earth that really don't matter at all in the light of eternity. And we get so busy, we get so frustrated, we get so filled up with doing things that are meaningless, then when something of meaning comes to our opportunity, we don't have time to do it. And people, that's got to change. We've got to come to a place where our first and most greatest priority in our lives is doing the very thing God's called us to do. What is that? Well, all the answers you gave me for the reason why we attend church, they're all good. They're all relevant. However, most of them are byproducts. Most of them are secondary. Most of them are just the benefits that come along with doing what you're supposed to do. But this is a primary and the most important reason why we gather together. It's to worship God. You see, we're all called to worship God on our own. Okay, when you're in your own private time, you're to worship God. You do it as part of your everyday life. It's there. But things change when you come together. Annie read the verse. Or quoted, right? Two or three are gathered, the Spirit of the Lord is there with me. Okay? When we gather together, God is with us. When we join together, and the example that we're given is the example of the old temple. Okay? How many of you remember the old tabernacle? Any of you there? No? Probably not. Well, if you read the Old Testament, it really describes this tent in great detail. There's a fence that goes all the way around it. Inside that fence is the tent. Inside that tent is a holy place. Inside that holy place, there's a veil that divides. Now, in those days, the high priest, who was born in the tribe of Levi, once a year, after offering a blood sacrifice and taking that blood atonement in with him, could go in and could lift up the curtain of the veil and enter in to the most holy place. Once a year, one person could enter into the most holy place. And that's the way it was for 1,500 years. Can you imagine that? Imagine for a moment what it would have been like to not be an Israelite. What if you were a Moabite and you saw this tent, you saw this going on, but you were excluded from it because you weren't an Israelite? Not only weren't you an Israelite, you weren't part of the tribe of Levi. Not only weren't you part of the tribe of Levi, you weren't a descendant of Aaron. No longer, you weren't just a descendant of Aaron, so you weren't the high priest, so you couldn't even enter in. You couldn't even go in to the fence that surrounded the tent. But there's a very good thing that changed for you and I. And it happened on the day that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. The veil in the temple was torn. And it wasn't torn from the top or the bottom like two men went in there and tore it. It was torn from the top down. You see, it was God himself who went into the Holy of Holies, the most holy place, and said, this is now no longer for one person once a year. This is now for all my people all the time. You see, for us who have been born into this age where the veil has been torn and we've lived in it our whole lives, we quite honestly take it for granted. We don't even consider it sometimes in the hectic pace of our life. But think back for a moment what it would have been like for somebody who was on the outside. What would have they have done? What would have they have given up to get a glimpse of the Most High? To see the Shekinah glory of God? What would have they done? What would have they given up? And for you and I, we can freely enter any time. But I'll tell you, it's a heightened experience when we do it together. When the church comes together and worships God in one accord, in one spirit, there is a level of power, there's a level of glory that occupies us in a way. And you guys know what I'm talking about. You've been there. You've been in those services where the glory of God just falls and there's nothing you can do but just soak in it. I'll tell you, that needs to be the norm. That needs to be the regular thing that happens and not just the exception. Because that is the primary, that is the main reason why God created the church. You know, hearing the Word of God, that's important, but that's not the prime reason. Don't think that that's why you're coming to church, is just to hear the Word of God. Don't think it's just to come and sing a song, or to hear a testimony, or to put your kids in Sunday school. Okay? Those are all good things, but they're all secondary. The most important thing is to meet with God face to face, and allow Him to share His glory with us. That is the most important thing. And if we get that into our heads, if we get that thought, there is nothing that could happen that would pull us away from that experience. Because there's no other experience on earth that would come close to being in the presence of God. There is nothing, nothing, nothing that you could ever think of with your brilliant mind that would come close to experiencing the love of God upon you. Now you're here today. You're hearing this message. But the ones who really should be hearing this message are the ones who aren't here. So how do we get this message to them? Well, you share it with them. You tell them. You see, I believe that there's another wave of God that's coming. I'm hoping it's this fall. But I can't tell you exactly when it is, because from what God has told me, it's dependent upon His people. It's dependent upon you and I when this wave is coming. And waves come all the time. Okay, look at the ocean. The waves are always coming. They're crashing in one after the other after the other. It's a regular occurrence. But when you look at somebody who surfs the waves, now I know we're like central Alberta, we don't do too much surfing here, but I'm sure you've seen it on TV or on holidays. But when somebody is surfing, what do? They paddle out, then they sit on their board and just let the waves take them. Is that what happens? No. You see, you sit on the board and you wait for the wave that you want, and then you have to start paddling. You have to paddle and you have to paddle, and your board has to match the speed of the wave that's coming in. You see, because if you just sit there, what happens?
The wave just goes right past you. It just goes right past.
And I'll tell you that God has sent many a waves through Edmonton that the church has just sat and just waited for it to go past. You see, the thing that God has really been teaching me lately is that He gives prophetic words, He gives understanding, but it's up to us to fulfill those words. You see, the prophecy isn't an absolute saying, okay, this is going to happen. It's, this is what God wants to happen. This is what God wants to happen in your life. And if it happens in your life, it's because you're going to do what you need to do to get to that place. It's like the surfer. When he's sitting out there and sees that perfect wave, he has to start paddling. He has to match the speed of that wave. And when that wave begins to crest, that's when he stands up. That's when he gets up on the board and can ride that wave in. It's the same thing when we're talking about the spiritual wave of God. When we see the wave coming, we have to get and we have to start paddling. We have to start getting in tune with what that wave is. We have to start going the same speed so that when that wave begins to crash, when it begins to curl, we can stand up and we can ride it in. And I'll tell you, people, that's when it gets fun. That's when it gets interesting. You see, the paddling isn't fun. Paddling out into the ocean isn't fun. Paddling in to catch a wave isn't fun. But when you are riding that wave, that's when the excitement occurs. And the same can be said about the Spirit of God. You see, there's low times in the wave. Okay? There are low valleys. Those are times when we gotta persevere. Those are times where we have to push through. Those are the times you gotta paddle for all you're worth to get to that place where you can ride it. But once you're on it, that's when the enjoyment comes in. So there are seasons to our life. And maybe you're in a season of low right now. Maybe you're in a season where things are difficult and they're hard. All I can say to you is keep paddling. Keep paddling. Keep pushing through. Keep going, because you're going to find that place where you're going to get on and ride that wave. And that's when you're going to find your peace, your joy, your contentment. Hebrews chapter 10. This is one I'm sure you're all familiar with. But maybe you don't understand, when it's been read, what it actually means. Because it actually has an obvious slant in it that might not be too apparent. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 19. It says, "So friends, we can now without hesitation walk right up to God into the holy place. Jesus has cleared the way by the blood of his sacrifice, acting as our priest before the God. The curtain into God's presence is his body. So let's do it, full of belief, confident that we are presentable inside and out. Let us keep firm grip on the promises that keeps us going. He always keeps his word. Let's see how inventive we can in encouraging love and helping out, not avoiding worshiping together as some do, but spurring each other on, especially as we see the big day approach. If we give up and turn our backs on all we've learned, all we've been given, all the truth we now know, we repudiate Christ's sacrifice and are left on our own to face the judgment. And a mighty fierce judgment it will be. If the penalty for breaking the law of Moses is physical death, what do you think will happen if you turn on God's Son, spit on the sacrifice that made you whole, and insult this most gracious Spirit? This is no light matter. God has warned us that He will hold us to account and make us pay. He is quite explicit. Vengeance is mine, and I won't overlook a thing. And God will judge His people. Nobody getting by with anything. Believe me. Remember those early days after you first saw the light? Those were the hard times. Kicked around in public, targets of every kind of abuse. Some days it was use, other days it was your friends. If some friends went to prison, you stuck by them. If your enemies broke in and seized your goods, you let them go with a smile. knowing they cannot touch your real treasure. Nothing they did ever bothered you. Nothing set you back. So don't throw it all away now. You were sure of yourselves then, and still a sure thing, but you need to stick it out. Staying with God's plan so you will be there for the promise of completion. It won't be long now. He's on the way. He'll show up and most any minute. But anyone who is right with me thrives on loyal trust. If he cuts and runs, I won't be very happy. But we're not quitters who lose out. Oh no, I stay with it and survive, trusting all the way. That passage of Scripture, you've probably heard it hundreds of times. You've probably read it. You've heard it. But when you look at the context of it, and you have to read back a few chapters and read it, the context is assembling together. Coming together as a church, as a body. And he's writing to them, when they say, when you're giving up, that's saying you're giving up attending church. Okay, you're giving up assembling together. This passage is about attending church. How many ever knew that? Yeah, some of you probably picked that up. But that is the point. That is the reason why it was written. It's assembling together because it's together that we can do what we're called to do. Now I want to take a step back and I want to kind of explain this next wave that's coming. In order to prepare for it, how do we paddle? Okay, we're using the allegory of a surfer paddling out. How do we do that in our spiritual life? Well, the first thing that God's revealed we need to do is we have to love God. That's the first and the primary. Now, it's offset by the fact that He first loved us. Okay, get that? He first loved us. It's only in understanding that He first loved us that we can truly love Him. And you know, this is something that we throw around lots. Sure, love God. God is love. It's a word that, quite frankly, has lost its power. It's lost its meaning. You see, love means that He loves you in spite of what you do. Think about that. Anytime you've denied Him, He loves you. Anytime you've done your own thing and rejected and turned your back on Him and what He's called you to do, He loves you. His love for you does not change. Now, for some of us, we have to do something really stupid before we fully realize His love. Other ones just need that blessing of God to flow over us before we understand His love. Some of us just need that wrap of His loving arms around us and feel it in a tangible way before we understand His love. But whatever it is, and every one of us receive love differently, okay? Understand that, okay? We're not all wired the same way. We're not designed the same way. If you think you are, ask your spouse. They'll tell you you're not. Okay? But we are all designed differently. We receive love differently. But this is the best part of it. The one who designed you is the one who loves you most. He knows how you need to be loved. He knows what it is that makes you feel loved. And it's not a mystery to Him. It's not something He has to figure out. He knows it. He knows how to express His love towards you. But it's for us to understand that love He's expressed. What do I mean by that? We need to take the time to understand it. We need to take the time to believe it. Okay? There's a big difference between believing it in your head and believing it in your heart. Okay? There's kind of those aha moments. You ever had one of those? Where you believe something in your head, and all of a sudden it gets transferred to your heart, and then it's like, oh yeah, that's what it is.
If you haven't had those experiences yet, dig deeper, okay? They happen all the time. But we got to get the head knowledge into our heart, because it's in our heart that it actually changes us. It's when it's in your heart, when you believe it in your heart of hearts, that's when things can start to happen. So the first step is knowing and understanding God's love for us, okay? It should be an automatic reciprocal for us to love him back, okay? When we understand God's love, the only thing we can do back, when we take in light of who we are, what we've done, the mistakes we've made, and the knowledge that he still loves us, there's only one thing left for us to do, and that's to love him back, okay? And it's only until you understand his love that you can fully love him back, okay? Other than that, it's always just words, okay? It doesn't hold much credence. But once you understand his love, you can love him back. Now, the next step after that is when you know God's love and you love God back, the next automatic response should be that you love his church. Have you ever had a friend that you really like his friend, but you can't stand his wife? Don't put up your hands, please. We're recording this. You know what? Have you ever told your friend, I don't like your wife? Would he get offended at that? Would that be a problem? Here, the one who he loves most in the world, and as his best friend, you don't even like her? There would be a problem there, wouldn't it? Well, the same thing happens in the church. You see, the church is the bride of Christ. If you love Christ but can't stand the church, you have a problem with Christ. Because he loves the church more than anything else. You see where I'm going with this? There should be an automatic response. Once you know God's love, you will love God and you will love his church. That means you will want to be. What is one of the signs of love? If you love somebody, what's one of the big things you want to do? Be with them, right? That's the natural byproduct of love. If you love someone, you want to spend time with them. It's like when you first start dating, it doesn't, and I can tell this because Shirley's downstairs, but it was amazing. When Shirley and I started dating, I would work till maybe 11, 12 o'clock at night. We would meet up at 2 o'clock in the morning just so I could spend a few hours with her, and then I'd get up at 4 o'clock in the morning to start working again. Like, those were the things that we would do in those days just to spend time together, okay? Because if you didn't, you wouldn't see anybody. You would do it. Now, would we do that now? Yes, I would. Okay. But love grows, okay? Love continues to grow. If you love the church, you will want to be a part of the church. The other aspect of love is not only do you want to spend time with it, but you want to serve. You see, if you love your spouse, it will be an automatic response to want to do things to help them, to want to do things that encourage them, to want to do things that build them up, to make them feel good. Maybe we do it a little bit more during the dating phase and a little less later on, but it's something that is a natural aspect, hey? You want to do those things, okay? You don't have to do them. You want to do them. And that's where, if you love the church, you will want to serve the church. You will want to serve, and you will want to reach out and minister. And it won't be because the pastor's twisted your arm into doing it. It won't be because they've been asking for 6 months for someone to fill this position and nobody's done it. It will be because you want to do it. The problem is... sometimes we put the cart before the horse, okay? We tell people, oh, you need to serve, you need to serve, you need to serve, but we don't start at the beginning where you need to love God. You need to love his bride. You need to want to serve and minister. Because it's only then that you will really get fulfilled, okay? If you're doing something out of duty and obligation, anybody fulfilled when they do that? Anybody happy when you're doing something you have to do? When are we most happy? Think about that. When are you most happy in your life? When you're sleeping? Yeah. Some of you, that may be true. What's that? Spending time with people you like? There you go. You're happiest when you're with those you love the most. Okay? That's probably the best way to sum it up. For us to be happy, we need to want to be there. Okay? Coming to church is not a have to. Okay? It needs to be a get to. And we need to have that attitude, and we need to weigh that attitude on our shoulders, on our sleeves, right? Because unfortunately, when we have this have-to attitude, people can read that off you anytime. You want to go golfing on Sunday? I can't. I have to go to church. What does that say? Does that person who's going golfing want to go to church now? No. And unfortunately, we do that all the time. Okay? Our attitude needs to be a real attitude. Okay? It has to be one that says, you know what, I want to go to church. So when someone asks you to do something on Sunday morning, it's not that, oh, I have to. It's, you know what, I'd love to go golfing with you, but I get to go to church on Sunday. And that, I just love being with those people. Guess what that does? They start thinking to themselves, wow, they would rather go to church than go golfing? I think I'm missing out on something here. Okay? And that needs to be our thought throughout everything, okay? It's a concert on Sunday night. Oh, but well, I have to go to church because we're having a Sunday night service. No. I get to go to church. I get to be a part of what God's doing. I get to enter the most holy place. I get to see God face to face. I get to be filled with His glory. That person's going to say, well, wow, maybe that concert's not a great idea. Maybe I'd rather come there. And that is the attitude change that we as a church need to exemplify. Now, I want to tell you something. As a whole in North America, church attendance is declining. Okay? It's happening. Now, the thing you might not have associated with it is that there's a direct correlation. If you look at the statistics of how the church is declining, and you look at the statistics of how people or soul winning is declining, it's proportional. If the church declines by 10% attendance, soul winning declines by 10%. There is a direct correlation. When people start losing their heart for the church, they stop inviting people to church. Makes sense, right? If you're not happy being there, why are you going to invite somebody else to be miserable with you, right? Well, we do that sometimes, but not in church, right? But that's where we have to change our attitude, okay? We need to change our thought process. We need to change that it's not going to church because I have to. It's there because I want to. Now, for those of you, you know that as a church here, our desire is to go beyond much more than just the traditional way of doing things. We want to create an avenue where each and every one of us are using our gifts, our talents, and our abilities to serve God. Okay? That means we want you to discover what your giftings are. We want you to take those giftings and use them. And just because it doesn't fit in the traditional mold doesn't mean that's the way it has to be done. We're open to those changes. We want a church of people who are invested in it. Okay? This isn't Pastor Stan's church. This isn't Pastor Sean's church. This is your church. Okay? You have to get that thought in your head. Okay? Well, for me, I say this is my church. But for you, you have to say this is my church. This is mine. You have to take ownership of it. Take responsibility of it. If you see something going on that you don't like, change it, right? This is your place of worship. This is your place to gather together. The person beside you is a person that God placed there by His divine wisdom. Okay? Get that. There's not a single person here that's here by accident. Now, I believe that there are many people here who aren't here but should be here. How can I say that? Because I know some of the things that God wants this church to do. I also know that the people we have aren't enough to do what God wants us to do. So I know that God has to bring in more people, and there's people he's told to come here who aren't here. So the next step is, after we know God's love, we love God back, we love his church, we begin to serve, the next aspect is to bring in those who are going to serve alongside of us. How do we do this? Well, I want you to think for a moment right now of somebody who should be attending church but doesn't. Okay? And the reason why I say this is, it's not our job to recruit people from other churches. Okay? If they're in another church, that's because God has placed them in that church, and just like he's placed you here. Now, if God tells them to move, God will tell them to move. It's not our job to go to them and say, oh, okay, you should come to my church instead. Okay? That's not the way it works. But there are enough people out there that we all know of that aren't attending church that should be attending church. Take some time right now and just think right now. And just let God bring names to your mind. Who are they? Who are these people? Well, the ones that God is bringing to your mind right now are the people that God wants you to get in touch with. And it's, put it this way. Let's say your mother was doing a big turkey dinner, okay? And it's a family affair. Everybody was coming together. It was Thanksgiving. And right before the Thanksgiving dinner, you decided, you know what? I can't go to that dinner because I got to mow the grass. I want you to think for a moment, how would your family respond to that? How would your family feel if you weren't going to come to Thanksgiving dinner because you had to mow the grass? Think about that. Now, if we are all one family in the body of Christ, isn't that how each and every one of us should think when somebody doesn't come to church because they have to mow the grass? Or because they have to do something else, whatever is on the list. You see, if we're family, each and every one of us should have that same attitude. If you're sitting here and looking around and somebody's not here, and notice, and just understand this. As pastors, we can't do that with everybody, okay? I can't make a list of, okay, there's 40 people missing today. Who are they? That's not the way it's supposed to work either. But if God has put somebody on your heart, that means he's called you to reach out to them. If you notice somebody isn't in church on a Sunday morning, call them up. Okay? I'll tell you, there's a practical aspect of this. When a pastor calls them up, it's like they're in trouble. Oh, I skipped church, now the pastor's going to call me. And it's a negative thing, right? But when you, as a member of this congregation, as a member of this church, see someone's not missing and you call them up, all of a sudden it's like, oh, they miss me. I must be valuable. I must be special. And that's what we really have to get every single one of you who is here today in that mindset. If you need someone's phone number, we'll find it, okay? We'll do that for you. But send them an email. Send them a text. Call them on the phone. Is everything all right? Is there something that you need help with? Is there whatever? See, and it's not until we, as the body of Christ, and I'll tell you something, in this church, we have a huge advantage in this upcoming wave, okay? Because we already kind of have this family atmosphere. We're kind of at that place. We need to take that mentality of the family and apply it to all aspects of the church, okay? If you have a birthday party and one of your family members doesn't show up, you're going to call them and find out something going on. Is there a problem? Did you get lost? Did you just forget about this date or whatever? You're going to investigate. We need that same mentality within the church. If somebody's not there, check up on them. Okay, it's not that you're controlling them. You're not, oh, you should be in church. No, okay, it's not that. It's, are you okay? Is there something I can help you with? Is there something that I can do for you? Okay?
And then if there is, call somebody else up and get them to help you do it, right? Do it together. It's not a solo act, okay? So first, love God. Second, first is God loves us, so we in return love him, okay? Third, you got to know this by now, somebody shout it out. Love his church, right? His bride. Four, serve, right? Serve, because out of love is going to be a natural aspect of service. It's going to be a natural aspect to want to do things, okay? The fifth aspect is we're talking about recruiting those who should be in the church, okay? Those people who have fallen astray. Now, we all know, you know the great word, backsliders. Someday somebody's going to have to explain what that actually means. Like, do you slide on your back, or what do you do? I don't know, but somebody somewhere means it, okay? But we have to bring in these people. Why do I say that? Because when God starts bringing in the new believers, like I believe he's going to do, we need all hands on deck, okay? We need to bring in those people who already know the truth but aren't living it, okay? We need to bring in those people first so that they can be encouraged. They can be built up. They can be healed, okay? When that happens, then there'll be more of us to do the work that God has called us to do. The next step after that will be starting to reach the lost, okay? Starting to reach those, and this is it's going to be a corporate effort. I can see that this wave, I'm not even going to give a time frame. The last wave that God sent, he told me it was a year long, okay? And it was just, how many of you remember that? We talked about that. It was a wave, and it was a wave of, where evangelistic opportunities were just going to be easier. There were going to be opportunities to speak to people was going to be made more abundant, okay? We missed that wave, okay? But that doesn't mean God's not going to send another one. And we want to catch this one. We want to be prepared. We want to live our hearts and our lives in a way that builds people up. Okay? And that brings me to another point. In church, in this community, we need to make sure that our relationships are done in love. Okay? It's so easy as a Christian to judge, right? But is that what God has called us to do? No, he is the judge. Okay? He's the one who's going to do the judging. That's not our job, so why do we do it? Okay? Just end that. We need to be to the place where, and this is difficult, but it's a change of mentality. How many of you have ever been hurt by somebody else? Okay, how many of you are lying and not putting up your hands? Okay. If you are in relationship, you will get hurt. Okay, that just goes without saying. Okay, it happens. We're all imperfect people, and when you put imperfect people together, you get imperfect relationships, and people hurt people. Okay, hurt people hurt people. You get that? Okay. We have to come to the place where we give the person the benefit of the doubt. Okay. I don't believe there's anybody in this place who would maliciously hurt you. Okay? I don't believe there is. If there is, we will talk to them and deal with them. Okay? But what we have to do is realize that most of the time that there is conflict is because of miscommunication. Okay? Where one person's thinking one thing and has these expectations, and another person's thinking this and has these expectations. The expectations don't equal, so when they hit, there's conflict. Anybody married? Yeah. You know when those conflicts come, right? You know when those things happen. The key to it is not to be easily offended, as the Word of God says. Okay. How many of you can be easily offended? Don't put up your hands. Okay. We can be. But we got to stop being that. Okay. Give the person the benefit of the doubt. They're not out to hurt you. They're not out to destroy you. They probably just did something without even knowing they did it and how it affected you. Okay, so you know my favorite expression, suck it up, princess. Okay, stop being so easily hurt. Okay, now when you are genuinely hurt, you got to deal with it. Okay, you got to go talk to the person, explain to them, okay,
this is what happened. I thought you meant this. Did you mean that? Give them the opportunity to explain, okay? Because for us, we often, as human beings, we see a person's actions, and from those actions, we interpret their attitude, okay? Which is a big leap in reality, okay? And usually it's because, well, if I did that, I would have been thinking this. So we take our own expression and put that on them and then say, well, you did this, so you must have been meaning that. Anybody with me so far? Okay. Instead, we got to get to the place where we ask them straight out. Communication. Okay. What did you mean when you did this? Okay. What was your intent? And give them the chance to answer. Okay. Don't try to... Nobody is good at reading other people. I'm good at reading other people. I just get it wrong. That's okay. But we all think we're masters of reading others. And I'll tell you, you can read people when you know people. Okay? For you women out there, you probably, your wives, you probably know what your husband's thinking before he's thinking, right? Men understand there's a problem with their wife without them saying anything, right? They know they've done something wrong, and now the challenge is to figure out what it was. Okay? Things like that happen all the time. In reality, what we should be doing is we should be going to them and saying, okay, I'm noticing some friction here. Can you explain to me what it is that has happened, right? That's how it works, should work in a marriage relationship. It should also work in church relationships in the same way. When somebody does something that offends you or hurts you, go talk to them. Okay, that's in the Bible, believe it or not. Okay, go talk to them. Not out of anger, not out of accusation, but just to make sure you're both on the same page. Okay, that's why the Bible says if you do that, go talk to them. If you still have a problem and can't come to a resolution, then bring somebody else alongside, okay, as a witness. And then kind of mediator. They can kind of sit in, break it up. Kind of get the two places working together. If that still doesn't work, that's when you kick them out of the church and say goodbye, okay? But we don't get to that point. Because there is always resolution, okay? There's always the opportunity to resolve. There's always opportunity to come together and have, you know what? We don't always have to believe the exact same things to agree that we both love the same God. You get that? We don't all have to drink the same type of coffee before we think we can work together in a ministry or serve together. Okay? We don't have to transform somebody into our own personal mold before we can work alongside them. Differences are great. How many of you like differences? Can you imagine if we were all the same? That would be boring, unless we were all like me, I guess. Then it would be interesting. Come on, you don't believe me? No. God is a God of diversity. He's created us all differently, and I think He did that on purpose, so that we could learn to develop character. Okay, we could learn to become more in this life. Because, really, you only develop character when you're hanging out with people who are different than you. You notice that? You only can resist temptation, and I don't know where this is coming from, but you can only resist temptation when you're in an environment where you might be tempted. Now, I'm not telling you to go out and get tempted so you can resist temptation. Okay, that's not it at all. But what I'm saying is there's that added component where inside these walls we are comfortable. Okay, inside these walls, you have the opportunity to use the gifts and the talents that God has given you. But I hate to tell you this, but that's your training grounds. These walls are a place of protection, a place of safety where you can learn to develop your giftings. But where you will use those giftings is outside of these walls. You see, we have prayer time at the front so you can practice coming up and praying for people to be healed. Why? It encourages you, it builds you up so that you can go out and pray for that guy on the street corner who needs healing. Scary? I hope so. It better be, because only that is going to develop your character. Only something that challenges you will build you up and make you stronger. Now I can start my sermon. We will leave that for another time. So everybody with me? First step. Come on, everybody say it. Love God. Well, it's tied to number one, which is know God's love. Okay? Love God. To love God, you must know that He loves you. Then the next one would be love the church, right? If you love somebody, you're going to love their bride. Okay? Sometimes you like the bride more than you like the groom, but that's okay. Right? The next is serve. Okay? Then part of that service is going to be reaching others, right? First of all, we want to go after the ones who should be here, okay? The ones who have backslidden, the ones who have fallen back, the ones... And they're going to be the hardest. They're going to be ones who are hurt. They're going to be ones who... Somebody hurt in the past, and they associated that with the church, okay? So as the church, you are the representative to go out and to deliver healing. Can you do that? Yes, you can. Once we get that in, the next phase is going to be reaching everybody else, using the gifts and the talents that you have practiced here within these walls. And God will give you the confidence, He will give you the boldness to go out and do that outside of these walls. Are you ready? Are you ready to start paddling? Are you ready to start moving in that place where you can catch that wave and stand up on that board? And that's when you will find your joy. That's when you will find your satisfaction. That's when you will find your perfect peace. And you got to love it the way the Bible says, a perfect peace that passes all understanding. Okay? So it's bigger than anything you could believe. It's bigger than anything you could understand. That's the peace that He's going to have for us. And I want to just end with this one last thing. God has promised us an abundant life. Now, in life, there are difficulties. In life, there are trials. Jesus promised that. Okay? In this life, you will have many, many problems. But those are not the norm. Okay? If you are in a place where you're living problem after problem after problem after problem, you're not where you're supposed to be. Maybe it's caused by somebody else. Maybe it's caused by some of your own decisions or actions. Whatever it is. But know this. God will not leave you in the valley. Okay? He will not leave you downtrodden. He allows you to experience those things so that you can more appreciate His grace, His love, His understanding, His mercy. So know this. The troubles are ending, and you don't have to wait till you die before they end. Okay, there's tons of verses that say your troubles are going away in this life and that God is going to raise you up. So, and this, I want to speak this word. This is to a few of you out there. Keep your hand on the plow. Keep working. Your labor is not in vain. Know that there is coming a time of peace and contentment that is beyond your wildest dreams, your wildest imagination. But just keep struggling through. And the other part of that is don't struggle alone. Bring somebody else in on your journey. Bring somebody else in to help you with where you're at. The reason for the church is that so nobody is alone. So that nobody is called to do anything on their own. So we have to change our thinking and our mindset that says, I'm in this by myself. No, you are not. If you are a member of this church, if you call Highway Christian Center your home, you are not alone. But it is your responsibility to reach out for help when you need it. Whether just to go to somebody else. And that's why it's so key that you foster relationships continually. So that during the good times you have the relationships that you can foster, you can build up, you can encourage. So when you go through those hard times, those relationships will then carry you. Get that. The relationships will carry you. So foster them now, because they will carry you through. Reach out to people. Tell them, you know what, if you're having a bad day, you do not have to put on a mask and say, oh, everything's fine. You know what? Sit down with a person. Tell them, you know what? Things are hard. Things are difficult. And what do you do if somebody comes to you and tells you that? Number one, it's not your job to solve the problems. Your job is to point them to Jesus Christ. How do you do that? You pray with them. Encourage them. Okay? Speak words of life over them. Build them up. Hold them in prayer, not only at that time, but throughout the week. If somebody tells you they're having a hard time, don't just say, I'll pray for you, and then leave it at that. Call them up a couple days later. How are things going? I'm still praying for you. Anything I can do to help? Okay? Once we get that mindset, once we get that where we can heal each other's wounds, then God will say, oh, you know what? You guys have got this understood. I am going to bless you with more people. I'm going to bless you with more relationships. I'm going to fill this place. But God's not going to give us anything that's going to destroy us. And so he wants to foster, he wants to form relationships within this local body of Christ that will stand the test of time, but will also last into eternity. Get that. They will last into eternity. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done. We thank you for your love. God, we thank you that while we were still messing around, you loved us. God, while we were still screwing up and making mistakes, you loved us. And your love for us just continues to overwhelm to our greatest being, Lord. And God, because you loved us, we naturally want to love you. We want to love your bride. We want to serve your people. And God, we want to reach out to everyone that you have called us to reach out to with the resources you're going to bless us with. God, there are those who aren't here in this place who need to hear this message. And Lord, we just pray that whether it be through the video or through the sermon tapes, God, that this message would just begin to flow out to every area. God, that it will just begin to touch the hearts and lives of every person who calls themselves a Christian and yet is not locked into a local church. God, we pray that you will just begin to minister to those who have backslidden, those who have fallen back, those who aren't attending a church anywhere, but God, they've heard your truth and they're just not walking in it. Lord, I pray, first of all, that you will just begin to soften their hearts, heal their wounds, Lord. And God, then place Christians in their presence, in their midst, to encourage them, to build them up, and to bring them back into the loving arms of your church family. Lord, we want to see a great revival released in this community. And God, I believe that you've laid out the blueprint of how this is going to happen. So, Lord, I pray that we would learn to do our parts and that we would do them well. That we would be able to separate those things out of our lives that hold us back and begin to focus our energies, our times, and our resources on things that really matter. And that's people. That's relationships. Help us, Lord, and let your grace and mercy follow us all the days of our life. And God's people said, Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. And I want to encourage you, if you're at that place where you need someone to pray with, reach out to somebody. You don't got to tell them everything. You can just tell them that, you know what, I need someone to pray with me. I need someone to help me. You can do that when we do our altar time at the front too. You can just come up and say, you know what, I need someone to pray with me. That's what we're here for. That's the purpose. God bless you and have a wonderful week.